guys. Prokofiev's great piano work, Sonata number 8 in B flat major, opus 84. Before we dive into the sonata, I wanted to take a look at Prokofiev's style, which he characterized as having these 5 lines, which I will also apply to this sonata. So the first line, the classical line, refers to the traditional classical forms that he uses. And in this sonata, the first movement is a sonata allegro form. The second movement is a rondo form. And then the third movement meshes the two together, so it's a sonata rondo form. And his forms are very clear cut, so in both the first and third movement, you will be able to tell when the recapitulations come in or when a new section starts. The modern line refers to his use of very adventurous harmonies, which I'm sure most of you guys will hear and understand. The motor line is a constant stream of rhythmic pulse, so repeated patterns and ostinatos, toccata-like passages, which you will hear in the beginning of the third movement. The lyrical line is this meditative, slow, melodic line. It was not a line that was not so developed in his earlier years until maybe around this time. So you hear it right from the beginning of the first movement with its long, kind of introspective, expansive lines. And then lastly, the grotesque or scherzo line, so full of mockery, sarcastic humor. It's a category that Prokofiev did not really appreciate being associated with, even though it is a distinctive quality of his music. And it comes out very apparent in the waltz of the third movement. So the war sonatas refer to his piano sonatas 6, 7, and 8, which he started writing in 1939, and he finished the last one in 1944. Around this time, he's living in Russia, and the German invasions are happening pretty frequently, and so the Russian government had to move him and many other musicians around constantly. He sees the crumbling conditions of his country around him, and so this really affects his writing, and he's writing very patriotically and nationalistically. You will also hear bells or fanfares in the sonata, and also Russian fairy tale-like moments, so dream-like, trance-like qualities, which, for example, the first beginning of the first movement. You can consider the three sonatas as a cycle. So if the first sonata refers to the beginnings of the war with its anxious energy in A major, the seventh sonata as being in the middle of the war, then the eighth sonata is the aftermath and the sentiments, the exhaustion after the war, which makes sense with the unusual slow movement that is the first movement. He dedicated the eighth sonata to his second wife, Mira Mendelssohn, which I don't think she has any relation to Felix Mendelssohn. And Emil Gilels performed this sonata December 1944. So this next slide is on the forms that I mentioned earlier. So the first one, Andante Dolce, you have your exposition, you have the first and second themes, the development, and the recapitulation with the first and second themes, except the recap is a little more compressed, and then a coda. The second movement is in rondo form, as you can see, with also a short coda at the end. And the third movement, the combination of a rondo and a sonata form. And likewise, the recapitulation is compressed. Interestingly, the sonata incorporates themes from bigger projects he had worked on previously, but that were never published or fully realized. So the theme of the first movement, one of the themes, came from music he wrote for the film The Queen of Spades, which is based on a story by Alexander Pushkin. And this project was meant to coincide with the centenary of Alexander Pushkin's death in 1937. But because of the tighter censorship in Russia, the film never got finished. but the music remains. And so if you see in the two pictures, he reverses the C period and the B period from the orchestration into the sonata. And he also transposes it from C major down to B flat major. So I will first play the orchestration, and then I will play a little bit of the piano sonata. From the first movement. He wrote, and so he pretty much took this exact orchestration and placed it into the second movement of the sonata, and this theme comes back constantly in that movement. So likewise, I will play the orchestration, and then I will play the opening of the second movement. Waltz So I placed where he puts it, just so it's a little clearer when you're listening. So the words in red are where the bells and fanfares will appear. The last one in the third movement in the coda, the fanfare, hopefully when I get there, it will be very apparent that it's a very heroic fanfare. Motivic elements. Prokofiev likes to take themes or little cells of notes and augments or transposes it or does both at the same time. And so the first example is from the first movement. So we have these four notes. After, he makes it into regular quarter notes and he augments it in the second example. So you have a little embellished and you have the augmentation down in the middle voice. And so he puts those together. And that example down below is just another example of how he continually transposes those four notes. Prokofiev knows how how to control his emotions, but does not shy away from touching gentle lyricism. He is not interested in pompous pathos. He found something better, simplicity and naturalness. And Oistrakh says, what struck me about Prokofiev's playing was its remarkable simplicity. Not a single superfluous gesture, not a single exaggerated expression of emotion, no striving for effect. So although you will hear the pain and suffering that he inputs into the sonata because of what was happening around him, I hope that you also hear the simplicity and gracefulness he writes in the sonata. So here is Prokofiev's